My name is Vivek. I am a software developer. I make videos about containers, Kubernetes, Go as a programming language, distributed systems, and sometimes about software engineering in general. So if you have been liking the kinds of videos that I make, you should consider subscribing to the channel and you should follow me on Twitter as well. In this particular video, we are going to continue writing the operator that we started in our last video. So let's quickly go ahead and very briefly discuss what are we trying to achieve or which particular operator we are trying to write and what are the things that we have already written or achieved. So we are going to, or we are trying to write this operator named cluster that is going to be responsible to spin up or create DigitalOcean clusters as soon as a cluster resource or a resource of type cluster with K, K-L-U-S-T-E-R, cluster is created on a specific Kubernetes cluster. So we are going to introduce a cluster type of resource, and as soon as someone creates that resource, this operator that we are going to build or that we are writing is going to spin up a DigitalOcean cluster using the specifications or configurations that are provided in that cluster resource. Now, if you have not watched the video that I'm talking about, the very first video of this playlist, I highly recommend doing that. You should also try to check out the videos where I talked about Kubernetes CRDs, CRs, and there is this another playlist where I actually wrote a Kubernetes controller, Kubernetes custom controller. So that video is also going to be very useful. Now, if we talk about the things that we have already achieved in the first video, so the very important part of writing operator or writing custom controllers for custom resources is generating the code for informers, listers, deep copy functions, and obviously client side. So we were able to do that in last video itself. Apart from that, we also used controller gen to use our types.go to generate CRDs. So all these things have already been covered. Now what we are going to do is we are actually going to write the controller that is going to be that should be notified, or that particular block of code should be called as soon as a particular cluster resource is either created or deleted from the cluster. So let's just go ahead and try to do that. So we are on the at the same state that we left our project in the last video. So let's run git status. We don't have any changes. We did change readme a bit, but that's pretty much it. Now let's run go build just to make sure that things are working as expected. Now let's go ahead and try to create another package inside package directory. So let's name it controller, and we are going to create a new source file named cluster.go inside controller. So cluster.go, this is going to be inside package controller. And to, again, if you have watched the other playlist that is about writing a Kubernetes custom controller, these things are going to be very easy for you. So now just to make sure, or just to bind the runner and other methods, let's just go ahead and try to create a struct that is going to have all the fields that are required to run a controller. So type, let's name it controller, and this is going to be a struct. Now let's talk about what are all the things that are required to run a controller. So we would obviously need a client set for the custom resource that we have introduced. So let's write client set for custom resource, that is cluster. Now once we have client set, the other thing that we need is we will have to figure out if the cache that informer maintains has been initialized or has been synced or not. So we know that from our previous videos, specifically where we talked about basics of client go, we know that informer maintains a local cache, And we will have to also have to have a way to figure out if that cache has been initialized. So we will have to have a way to make sure cluster cache has synced. Now the other thing that we would have to have is a queue where we can add the objects as soon as they are added or deleted from the cluster, so that we can later get those objects from this queue and then process them. So we would also need a queue, and we would also need a lister. So again, all these things are going to make much more sense if you have watched other videos. So lister is again this interface that Informer provides, and using lister we can get and list objects from lister itself, and we will not have to call the API server directly. So all these things are required to initialize this controller. Now if we talk about client set, let's name it client, and this is going to be of type of cluster client set. So we know that this is the client set that we have generated. So this is the package that we will have to import. So client set and version. So let's just go ahead and try to import that. So github.com/vbxing-ggits and cluster, and we know that this is our module. If we go to go.mod file, we can see that this is our module. That is the reason we are starting the import with this particular name. After cluster we have package, and after package we have client and client set and then versioned. So let's name it client set, and this client is going to be of type client set dot interface. Now that we have this particular field type specified, let's specify cluster has synced or not. So let's name it cluster synced, and this is going to be of type cache dot let me refer to the previous code that we have already written. So this is going to be cache dot informer synced. Now that we have cluster synced type specified, let's go ahead and try to specify lister. So let's name it klister, and the type is again going to be from the package that we have already generated. So this was for our client set, and we also have generated listers. So listers, this is group version, and then we have cluster. So this is the package that we will have to import. So let's just go ahead and try to do that. So package client, and then we are going to get inside listers, and for listers we have vvxing.dev v1 alpha 1, and let's call it klister, and this is going to be cluster lister. And the other very important thing or piece of the controller is this work queue that we maintain, and as soon as a particular cluster resource is added or deleted, we add that particular object in this work queue so that we can later get those objects to process them. So let's name it work queue, and this is going to be of type work queue dot rate limiting interface. Now this is an interface, but when we try to initialize this controller, we will actually have to specify which particular implementation we want to use for our queue mechanism. Now that we have specified all these fields, let's write a function that is going to initialize this controller. So func new controller, and this is going to return a new controller. Let's initialize a new controller. Alright, now to initialize a controller, we would need a client set. If you see here, to initialize a controller, we need a client set. So let's do that. And we know that client set is going to be of type client set dot interface, and we would also need informer, but informer for this custom type. So let's name it cluster informer, and this is going to be of type again the informer that we have generated. So informer external versions vweek sync dev and v1 alpha 1. So let's import that as well. So client and informers external versions, and then we have group and then API, group and version, and let's name it K informer. All right, now that we have these things, let's initialize the fields of controller just to return the actual controller so that we can call it from main.go and then we can actually run it. So client is going to be client, cluster synced is going to be cluster informer.informer.hasSynced, because we know that we have discussed that informer maintains a cache. That is the reason using informer we would be able to figure out if cache has been synced or not. To initialize lister, again lister is part of informer, so we are going to initialize lister this way, and then for work queue we are going to use named rate limiting work queue implementation, and this also expects rate limiter. So we are going to specify rate limiter to be a default controller rate limiter, and then we will also have to specify a name. So let's specify name to be cluster, and I think we are good here. Now that we have controller, we are returning the controller, but before that let's just go ahead and try to register the functions. So that as soon as a particular cluster resource is created, these functions would get triggered, and that is the whole point of writing this controller. So C dot, or let's say C cluster informer dot informer dot add event handler, and we are going to register the event handlers now. So cache.resource event handler funcs, and here we can specify add and delete func. So add func, and then we can also specify handle add. Let's define handle add function. So signature is this. So now if you see, this simply says that as soon as a cluster resource is added, because if you see, we are using cluster informer here. So as soon as a cluster resource is added, this particular function should get called. Similarly, we will also have to, we are also interested in delete events. So let's register delete func as well. So handle delete and func controller handle delete. And delete also has the same signature. Now, we have already discussed that as soon as a particular cluster resource is either added or deleted, we just have to add those resources in the work queue. And another go routine that runs continuously is going to process those items by getting them from work queue. So let's maybe log very simple message saying handle add was called, and then add the object in the work queue. Similarly, if delete was called, we also want to log it. So handle delete was called and add the object in the work queue. All right. Now, what we have to do is we have to run a routine, or let's say we have to run a go routine that is going to run continuously, and that go routine is going to get the objects from this work queue and then process them. But before that, let's go ahead and try to look into this main.go. So we have client set for our custom resource, and we don't necessarily need these things, so let's maybe remove them. Now we have to call new controller from this package, so let's first import that. So package and then controller. And from controller, we want new controller. And new controller obviously expects a client set. So we already have client set. And then it also expects cluster informer. But to get cluster informer, we will have to call informer factory for this custom resource. So let's try to do that as well. But we know that we have already generated the code. So client and then informers, external versions. So this is what we have to import, factory.go. And we know that factory is an external versions package. So let's do this. GitHub.com, vivek-singh-zzits, package, and inside package we have to go for client and then informers. So client inf informers, and for informers we have to use external versions, and let's call it cluster informer factory. So cluster informer factory dot new shared informer factory, and this expects a client. So we are going to pass client set for the custom resource, and we also have to pass default resync time. Now if you don't exactly know what default resync time is, I think you should check out the playlist that I have about basics of client go. So it gets us informer factory, and then when I call controller dot new controller, we can pass informer factory dot vivek-singh dot v1-alpha-1 dot clusters. Now that we have controller here, let's go ahead and try to run informer, or try to start informer. So informer factory dot start. Start expects a channel, so let's make that channel as well. So channel ch is going to be a channel of type empty struct, and here we go. Now that we have started, Informer Factory, we should call a method on controller that is going to run a go routine, or that is going to run in a go routine, and that is going to consume objects from the work queue and process them. So let's run that. Let's create that method now. So let's name that run, and that run should be a method of for type controller. And okay, now this is going to return, let's make it return an error and return false. And call c dot run now. All right. So, and if error is not nil, in that case, error running controller, and this is the error. All right. So I think we are good here. What we have to do now is we just have to implement this. So before actually running the controller, we should make sure that the local cache that is being maintained in Informer has been initialized at least once. So to do that, what we can do is if cache dot if c dot cluster sync dot hold on, I think I will have to refer the code for this. So it's cache dot wait for cache sync, and we will also obviously have to specify which particular cache we want to wait for to get synced. So the first argument is stop channel, so let's make run expect a channel of type struct, empty struct excuse me. And then we have to pass the cache. So the cache that we are interested in is c dot cluster synced, and I think it returns a bool response. So if not okay, this simply means that cache was not synced. So let's just print that. So log dot println cache was not synced. Now that we know cache has been synced, we should run worker, or we should run a go routine that is going to consume the objects from this work queue continuously. So let's do that, and we are going to use this utility from API machinery to run this worker. So wait dot until, and this is the function. So if you see here, this is the reason we are calling wait dot until. So it says until or this function loops until stop channel is closed. So this particular function expects a channel, and it runs this particular function every period second or every period until this particular channel is closed. So that is the reason we are using this particular utility. So let's call our function worker, and period is, let's say, every second, and then we have to pass channel as well, and let's pass this in. Let's run this as a go routine, and let's implement this worker function. Okay, now that we have worker function, what we can do is we can call another function that is actually going to do things for a created cluster resource. So let's call that function to be, let's say process next item, and let's call this function continuously. So for c dot process next item, return true. Okay, now obviously we are calling this function continuously. If this particular function returns false, we go here and then this particular wait dot until calls C worker again. So this is how this controller is set up. Now there might be other better ways. So for example, you can try to, here you see that we are spinning up only one go routine, but you can also try to spin up n number of go routines, and that n can be an argument to this particular function. So yeah, I think this is, we are good here. Now let's just go ahead and try to build this. Okay, so it says v1 alpha 1 dot resource is not defined, so the error is from listers cluster.go. Okay, so this resource is not defined. It looks like we have to get a resource and we should return schema.groupResource. So we have to write a function named resource that gets a resource and returns schema.groupResource. So let's go ahead to our register.go and let's write that function. So func resource, and it gets the resource as string and it returns schema.groupResource. Yeah, here we go. So now this works. And if we talk about implementing this, so it is going to return, we have scheme group version, so scheme group version dot with resource, and we have the resource dot group resource. So I think we are good here. Now let's go ahead and try to build this again. Okay, so main.go, we have to pass channel as well. All right, here we go. Now let's go ahead and try to create CRDs and CR just to make sure that these logs are being printed as soon as we create or delete the CRs. So we know that the CRDs are inside manifests. So kubectl create hyphen f manifests, and then we generated these CRDs in last video. So if you want to check out how we can generate the CRD using this types.go, you can do that by watching that video. Okay, so it says failed to list, returned object must be a list, object does not implement the list interfaces. I know about this particular error. I faced this while implementing the operator. So this happens because if you see here, the type that we have for cluster list here, object meta, when we specify a normal type like cluster, we specify object meta as object meta, but for list types we specify object meta as, sorry, metadata about object as list meta. And now I think this should work. Okay, so we will have to regenerate. We will have to regenerate the deep copy functions that we have already generated. So let's run. Let's run our generate groups. Again, code generator again, just to make sure that the deep copy functions and other generated files are updated. But before that, let's make sure that we have exec directory set. Okay, so this is going to regenerate all the deep copy functions, client sets, informers, and listers. So these particular deep copy files would be updated, and we shouldn't have any problem after that. So let's wait for this to be generated, and as soon as this is generated, now let's go and run go build. Here we go. Okay, so we have run cluster. Now let's go ahead and try to create the CRD. I think CRD is already created. Let's go ahead and try to create the CR. So create hyphen f manifests and then cluster one. And here we go, handle add was called. And if I delete this particular cluster resource, so if I show you this particular cluster one manifest, we are just creating a cluster resource. And if I try to delete this, if you see, handle delete was called. So now I think we are set up with our basic skeleton. Now let's go ahead and try to implement our process next work item. So all we have to do is we have to get the resource from the cache. So to do that, what we can do is cache dot or c dot work queue dot get, and it gives us item and shutdown. Yeah, so if shutdown, in that case we should return false, and then maybe we can log as well. If everything is fine, we got the item. Now for item, what we can do is we can use another utilities from cache to actually figure out namespace and name for the object that was added here. So if you see, we added the entire object in the queue, but we can use some utilities from cache to actually figure out namespace and name. So let's call it key colon error equals to cache dot meta namespace key func, and this expects item and returns key and error. So if error is not equals to nil, in that case we should log dot printf error calling namespace key func on cache for item, and error is going to be this. Now once we have key, what we can do is we can actually use another utility function to figure out the exact namespace and name of the cluster resource that was created. So let's do that. Cache dot, I don't exactly, yeah, split meta namespace key, and this expects a key and returns, if you see here, split meta namespace key expects a key and returns namespace, name, and error. So namespace, name, comma, error. If error is not equals to nil, return false, and we will have to log as well. So splitting key into space and name, and we got this particular error. Okay, so now if we have, when we have namespace and name of the cluster resource, and once we have processed that particular resource, we should make sure that we have removed that object from work queue. So let's do that by calling defer c dot work queue dot forget and this item. So if everything goes fine, we should forget the item from the work queue. Now that we have namespace and name, what we can do is we can get the exact object that was created by using Lister. Now if you see here, we are not going to call API server to list the things. We are going to use the Lister that we have initialized as part of controller. So let's do that. So c dot klister dot clusters dot get, and we are going to get expects a name. So we are going to pass the name, and it clusters expects a name, and this gets us, if you see here, v1 alpha 1 dot cluster. So if error is not equals to nil, in that case, right now I'm returning false, but yeah, later we will also look into how we can retry these things. So return false and then log dot printf error percentage s getting the cluster resource from Lister, and here we go. Now let's just print the cluster resource that we got from the queue. So log dot printf cluster spec that we have is percentage plus p, and let's print the cluster spec. All right, let's run it now. But before that, let's delete, all right, we have deleted the cluster resource already. So go build, and now we are going to run cluster again, and let's create the cluster resource. So cluster one, and here we go. So if you see cluster one, we have specified name, reason, and version, and that is what we are able to see here: name, reason, and version. So handle add was called, handle add added the object in the work queue, and then our worker got this particular object from the work queue. Now what we are going to do is, once we have all these resources, we have to call DigitalOcean APIs to actually spin up the Kubernetes cluster. We have all the details using which we can call the DigitalOcean APIs. Now, the other thing that I wanted to talk about is, so we have already looked into this in the first video. So these are all the things that are required to create a cluster. So all these things are being specified in the cluster resource, and those are all the things that we are able to get from cluster or in cluster spec. But if we look at Go implementation here at the right hand side, we would also need DigitalOcean token, and we have not talked about how are we going to specify how are we going to provide DigitalOcean token to our code base, to our controller, because without DigitalOcean token, we will not be able to call DigitalOcean APIs. So one thing that I can think of is, and that is what we are going to do, if we talk about, let's say, our types.go for cluster spec, apart from name, reason, and version, name, reason, version, and node pools, what we can do is we can try to get another field named secret name, and that secret is going to have the DigitalOcean token. So let's do that. So let's call it secret name, or let's call it token secret, and name is going to be string, and we can have token secret as well. Now once we have token secret, what we will have to do is we will have to regenerate CRDs as well. So we can either use controllers in, or this change is very small, so I'm going to change the CRD by myself. So we have reason, version, and here we also we can specify token secret, and this is going to be of type string. Okay, now when we create a cluster resource, we can also specify a secret name. So token secret, and let's say I have specified my DigitalOcean token in a particular secret named DO secret. So this is how we can specify that secret. So let's go ahead and try to run these things again. It says unknown field token secret, and the reason is we have not recreated the CRD. So let's go ahead and try to recreate the CRD as well, because we added a field in CRD but we have not reapplied that. So manifests, and then okay, so we see here custom resource definition has been configured. So create hyphen f cluster one, and here we go. So now cluster spec is being printed, and we have token secret as well, that is DO secret. And once we have the secret name in our controller.go, we can actually get that secret from API server to figure out the actual token that is stored in that secret. So all these things we are going to look into in next video, where we know the secret name where DigitalOcean token is stored. So we are going to read that token from the secret, and then we are actually going to call the DigitalOcean API to spin up the Kubernetes cluster for this particular cluster resource that we just created. So yeah, I think this is what I wanted to talk about in this particular video. If you liked this video, make sure you subscribe to the channel. You should like this video. If you think this is going to be helpful to some of your friends, colleagues, classmates, share it with them. And if you have any question, I have already said this, I answer almost every question that you comment. So don't hesitate to post your question in comments, and I'll see you in the next one. Thank you so much for watching.